Blazing the trail, the Jane Wayne of justice is circling the courthouses of America, speaking up for those who have been silenced. Susan Murphy Milano declares, time's up. And now, back to Susan Murphy Milano, because there's never too much Susan Murphy Milano.
For our last segment, we thought we would change things up a bit. We had last week on, we had Bernadetta Villa with Clara Colon and Nancy Rojas Mendoza for police officers' wives who across the country are not listened to and that they suffer in silence. I'm looking at Bernadette's emergency order of protection. Any knowing violation of any order of protection forbidding physical abuse, neglect, exploitation, harassment, intimidation, interference with personal liberty, willful deprivation or entering or remaining present at a specified place when the protected person is protected or present, granting exclusive possession to the residence, da da da. With respect to protected persons, that means Bernadette. Respondent is prohibited from committing the following: physical abuse, harassment, interference with personal liberty, and stalking. And you have gone to court, Bernadette, as we spoke last week, and you have to go back tomorrow morning. And they are not going to look at the text messaging in any way as an violation of the order of protection. But tell us what's going on with you all week, and just the officer who from Internal Affairs who just didn't follow up and after he promised to do a police report for you if the judge didn't do anything in court.
Yeah, well, basically it's the third time. I'm on the emergency order of protection. The last time we went to court, I told them about that he had violated the order, and I showed them the texts. They didn't even want to look at them. They said we're not gonna file charges. I'm like, why? And they said because they're too hard to prove. And the judge wasn't there that day, so they used to reschedule it for Tuesday. So when I went Tuesday, I brought my paperwork again, but I printed the law where it says the law in Illinois that he cannot call text me or anything. And then I told them, and they're like, well, we know the law, too. And I'm like, but it's saying right here in black and white. Are you telling me that you're not going to do anything? And they go, well, we're going to let the judge know about it. So when we get up there, the first thing, that's why they rescheduled it for this week, because he is asking for his service revolver back because he is on a no-pay status, which doesn't make any sense because he used the gun against me, so why would they give him his gun back? That doesn't make sense that his lawyer is asking for that. And even the judge told him, that's kind of ridiculous, don't you think? But so now we have to wait another week, till tomorrow, so that they could bring a witness saying that, it's okay for him to get a service revolver back, but they won't give it to him. But that doesn't make any sense either, so we'll find out about that tomorrow. But as far as the order about the text messaging, she told me again, no, she wasn't going to, that she would let the judge know. But this is how she let the judge know. She goes, oh, I also want to bring up, we are not filing charges on this, but there has been some text messaging. And I'm looking at her like, that's it? For me, that's the form showing that he does not follow directions. He does not follow orders. How is he going to, if you tell him, don't come with your gun after they give it to you, he's not going to kill you. If he can't even not violate an order of protection. And they didn't think that was important enough for the judge to know that.
What did they do the week before in court? They took out something without your knowledge, basically. It's kind of an FU as far as I'm concerned. And they removed the physical abuse wording in there.
Yeah, when I was there, because it was a different judge, the regular one was on vacation, and then his attorney said, I'd like it stricken from the record that there was physical abuse. No, and his lawyer and the attorney, the state's attorney said, okay, both of them, and they just struck it from the record. Nobody asked me, did he hit you? No, they just struck it from the record.
How can they do that? I mean, they can just arbitrarily decide.
This is a classic case of murder in progress, in my opinion, because
it makes it makes you not want to go back, because
right.
I'm like, what am I going back for if you guys are not doing nothing? You're not helping me. And then she told me, the state's attorney told me, I'm his victim. She says, no, you're not a victim. You're his witness. And I go, excuse me? And then she told me, are you in a safe place? Are you in a shelter? And I tell her, yeah, I'm in a safe place. She goes, well, then what's your problem? That's what she told me. I told her, you're not living how I'm living. You're not living in hiding. You can live your life day to day. And you're going to tell me what's my problem? I've been doing this for 3 weeks with you guys, and I'm in hiding. I can't see my mom. I can't see my kids. But I sure have no problem just because I'm in hiding. Well, he's walking around free thinking that he's going to get his guns back. It doesn't make any sense.
Because they don't and they won't deal with, and Chicago is the Fraternal Order of Police, and they won't deal with these as crimes. They don't look at this, but this person is trained, as they all are who commit acts of violence. They are trained with weapons. They are trained with terroristic tactics to use against criminals on the streets. But when they do this to their own family, they're not treating this as a crime. They're treating this as, oh, he just didn't know what he was doing. He won't do it again. But he has done it again, because you dropped things last time. You went back. And now this time you've had enough, you are done. Also because the last time, too, the system did not support your efforts in going for help, did they?
Yeah, no. And then, and even that day on Tuesday, the my supposed attorney told me, well, we got to wait for them to come, because he shouldn't lose his job over this.
Talk about the detective from IAD who promised you.
Yeah, he was going to take care of his name, but
promised you on Thursday, before you had court last week, that what he would do for you.
He told me, he goes, address it in court. If they do not address it in court, then call me and I'll take care of it, because he violated the order. There's no doubt about it. I called him. I had to wait till Sunday because he was on vacation. He was on his stage.
And we have this lovely detective on a tape saying this.
And he
doesn't realize that he's been tape recorded.
Yeah, I asked him. So, because he goes, well, if the state's attorney's not going to do nothing, then why should I arrest him? I go, because you told me that you know that he violated the law. And he told me, so you're telling me because they're not going to do their job, you're not going to do yours. He goes, basically, yes. He goes, what's the point if they're not going to do it?
What's the point?
Just gonna throw it away.
Oh, yeah, that says it all. What's the point?
Mm-hmm. You know, that's what he told me, and then the judge wants to know, because they're saying he's asking for a service revolver back because they're on a no pay status, and my court advocate that works for the police department, but she's on the victim side. She goes, well, he's got vacation time and he's got furloughs, and I for a fact know that he has 600 hours on the books because he never takes off. The judge actually said, well, I don't want him to lose his vacation time over this. So who's thinking for me? Nobody's asking nothing for me. He's the one that did something, and everybody's worried about Joe's not getting paid, and you know, he shouldn't use his vacation time, but nobody asked me anything. I'm just standing there because I am a witness. They don't even consider me a victim. They consider me a witness. And I told the state's attorney, I go, you know what? If you give him back his guns, you might as well hold me down and put so he doesn't miss, because you know who he's coming after? It's going to be me. And my blood is going to be on your hands, but you guys don't care. I'm living in fear here. I can't even go outside. You know, I'm always looking all around. I don't know when this is ever going to end. But they still don't. They're not listening to me. They don't let me talk, but they let his attorney ask for everything, and they won't let me ask for anything. They wouldn't even show the judge the Texas, you know, and that shows that he does not follow orders. He said he can do anything he wants, and they were not going to do nothing, and he is right. He's proving them right. He's laughing in my face right now, just like he was laughing when he told me, no matter what you do, they're not going to do nothing to me. And that is exactly what's happening.
Talk about real quick about the and then the chaplain, who was a former police officer who is his buddy. He comes in the hallway, and to me this is a form of intimidation, third party. He says to you what?
He tells me, on Tuesday he brings the pastor, the guy that married us, to talk for him to me, and he's like, oh, you know, Joe has a lot of problems, and, you know, you guys can work it out, and he loves you, and it's like, no, he doesn't, and he's like, you know, you guys can work it out, he shouldn't lose his job. Everybody is worried about him losing his job. Well, you know what? You guys put him on the street, and why don't you let him be in your neighborhood? Why don't you let him parole your neighborhood? If you feel he's so safe and he's not crazy and he's been charged 3 other times with domestic abuse.
Yeah, 3 other times he's been charged.
And, but you guys think he's okay and fit to be on the street? Well, let him go
here. What are the rules? How many times did he
have to
be
charged? Oh, come on. It doesn't work that way. And we don't have a lot of time. So I'd like to make a plea here to the Cook County State's Attorney, because this is, you know, recorded, and this is the best way.
I want somebody to help me.
Case number 11, D as in dog, V as in victory, 70368. This is an order of protection. This is a police officer's wife, and you have to do more than give this lip service. Bernadette Avila needs our help, as do all of the victims and the wives of police officers. The last 2 days we've seen a woman recovered in one state and another one is missing from Florida. This has got to stop. These women are losing their lives at record rates, in many cases by the hands of very clever, very abusive persons with military and law enforcement backgrounds who are experienced at tactical and terroristic-like treatments towards their victims.
He has both.
He has both. Mm-hmm. He was a Marine. Let's pretend just for a second, because we only got a minute here, Bernadette. The state's attorney, Alvarez, is listening to this right now. What would you like to say to her? In Spanish, if you want.
Please help us. We're victims. These are not just ordinary cases. These are men that have authority. They can carry guns. It's not just a regular Joe Schmo case. These men are, by law, can carry guns, but they're not using them properly. So they should do something about them. When there's allegations of them using their guns and having them all over the house and not doing what they're supposed to do with them and using them against their victims, their wives, they should be treated as a different case, not a normal everyday case, because it's not. We live with them day in, day out, them telling us that they're untouchable. No one will touch them. No one will do nothing to them. And the Cook County is proving them right. That's why they keep doing what they're doing.
And that's why your girlfriend Nancy died. We're out of time. For Delilah and myself and the crew here at the Zeus Radio Network, we will see you next week. God bless and be safe.